the glory, great things he has done. Through love in the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life and the bondage for sin, and opened the light gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, so Jesus the Son, and gave him the glory, great things he has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, where every believer the promise of God, the vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus and pardon received. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and gave him the glory, great things he has done. Great things he has got, great things he has done, and great all rejoicing to Jesus the Son. But power and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and gave him his glory, great things he has done.
Good morning, everyone. We hope you had a fantastic week, and welcome to our 10:30 Sunday morning service. Last week was a baptismal service, and congratulations to our two candidates who took this wonderful step in following Jesus. If perhaps you were thinking about being baptized or wanted to be baptized, please contact Pastor John Luke and he can start that process with you. There is always time for baptism at Shiloh. We just want to remind everyone that though we are in step 3 of the reopening plan and are only limited by social distancing, we still have some limits. So we hope that if you are planning on coming, that you give us a few days' notice so we can ensure there is room for you. An announcement that was made last week and a letter was sent out concerning joint service between Shiloh and Tiverton Baptist Church. The board would appreciate your feedback on that, and we do invite it. If, by any chance, you didn't get either an email or a physical copy of that letter, please let us know. Our passage for worship and confession comes from Isaiah 12, verses 1 and 2, the English Standard Version, and it reads,
"You will say in that day, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, for though you were angry with me, your anger turned away that you might comfort me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my song, and he has been."
Isaiah 12, verses 1 to 2. "You will say in that day, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, for though you were angry with me, your anger turned away that you might comfort me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation." Salvation, if you remember when we were doing our paraphrase of the Psalms, so often can be equalized or equivocated by the word rescue. God is our rescue, and he saves us from our sins. Glory be to Jesus. Would you pray with me as we lift our hands in praise and worship to God? Almighty God, we bless thy name. Holy and everlasting Father, we praise and we adore thee. We thank thee, O God, for thy kindness, thy grace, the forgiveness of sins made available by the blood of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, Son, only begotten of the Holy Almighty Father. And Holy Spirit, you who are with the three in one God, we ask that you would abide with us this morning in our service, that the triune God would be present here, and we would have a wonderful time of worship. We glorify thee, O Lord, and we praise thy name in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the song that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How preciously the grace appeared, the hour I believe. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He with Him my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. Through many dangers, tools and snare, I have already come. His grace that brought me safe so far, and grace will lead me home. Jesus, oh my Savior, His hand holds the earth. Jesus, our Creator, praise Him for His birth. Yes, oh come and let us worship, oh come and let us sing. Glory, glory to the Father. Glory, glory to the Son. Come, oh come, and let us praise Him with all our heart indeed. He is worthy, love, and holy because He cares. Your name is power, breath, and living water. I sing to the King. You are my everything. Yes, so come and let us worship. Oh, come and let us sing. Glory, glory to the Father. Glory, glory to the Son. Come, come and let us praise Him with all our heart in thee. He is worthy, love, and holy because He cares.
If you have your Bible, you can go with me to the book of Haggai. The book of Haggai. This is going to be our first scripture reading in the book of Haggai. I'm not going to give us a reflection as much anymore, but let us go to the book of Haggai, and I still would like to read, though, with you from Haggai chapter 1, verses 1 to 9. Allow me to give the context for this. The children of Israel, when they had lived in the promised land for some time, eventually they turned away and they worshipped Asherah, they worshipped Baals, they worshipped many, many other gods and did all sorts of abominations, even offering their children to demons as sacrifices. That's the testimony of Scripture. And so the Lord cast them out of their land because of their sin. But God is the Almighty, and He is merciful and kind and full of love. So He brought them back to the promised land. The promise did not break or give up just because they broke and gave up on the promise. Don't we serve a faithful God? A faithful God. And so when they came to the promised land, they of course had the task of rebuilding the house of the Lord, the temple, because it was time to worship God again, to worship Him there. And they reached a point where they faced opposition in building this temple, and so they stopped the construction of the temple. And that is not a good thing, because they were cast out from the land because of their failure to worship God. And when they faced opposition, they gave up. But the Lord was merciful, is merciful and kind. He saw the circumstance. He saw the situation, the challenges they were facing. His eye was not blind to what they were going through. So He sent His prophets to prophesy and to encourage the people to build the house of the Lord, because it was the time for building. We find that in Ezra chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. There are two prophets mentioned there by name, Haggai and Zechariah. And one of those prophecies concerning the building of the temple is recorded for us in the book of Haggai chapter 1, verses 1 to 9, which we are going to read here this morning. It's all about times and seasons in the Lord God of heaven. Would you read with me this morning? The white I will read, the orange, or you may read with me as well, together. Haggai chapter 1, verses 1 to 9, the English Standard Version. In the second year of Darius the king, in the sixth month, on the first day of the month, the word of the Lord came by the hand of Haggai, the prophet, to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Thus says the Lord of hosts, these people say the time has not yet come to rebuild the house of the Lord. Then the word of the Lord came by the hand of Haggai the prophet. Is it a time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses, while this house lies in ruins? Now therefore, says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and harvested little. You eat, but you never have enough. You drink, but you never have your fill. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages does so to put them into a bag with holes. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the hills and bring wood and build the house, that I may take pleasure in it, that I may be glorified, says the Lord. You looked for much, and behold, it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away. Why? Declares the Lord of hosts. Because of my house that lies in ruins, while each of you busies himself with his own house. I really want to end on the note of verse 8. Go up to the hills and bring wood and build the house, that I may take pleasure in it, that I may be glorified, says the Lord. Now is the time, my friends, to glorify the Lord. Would you join me as we worship the Almighty God together this morning? How about I pray before we continue with our singing? Almighty God, Holy Lord, who made heaven and earth, we praise Thee, we thank Thee, and we adore Thee, three in one God. We thank You especially for the blood of Jesus Christ shed on the cross for the forgiveness of sins. We ask this morning that You would wash us clean and deliver us from the hold sin has on our lives, that we may take pleasure in building Your house, that You may take pleasure in us, so that You, O Lord, may continually, may always be glorified. We praise and we worship thee, O God, in Jesus' name. O come, Holy Spirit, to our worship, in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the cross, in the cross.
I'd like to thank Herman, Ruth, my beautiful wife Jessica. Thank you so much, guys, for leading us in our time of musical worship. It is such a blessing. We are in the live service today outside, and I'm really believing for good weather because this is a pre-recording, and I'm believing for good Sunday weather. Praise God. But regardless of the weather, regardless of the season, the passage is the same. The word of the Lord this morning is coming from the Gospel of John, the 5th chapter and the 37th down to the 39th verse. That's what we're going to be reading. It's these three verses. Now, in John's Gospel, it deals a lot with the identity of Jesus, especially in his relation to the Trinity. Jesus as the only begotten Son of the Father, John 3:16, that famous verse. Jesus is the one who sends the Holy Spirit who is one with the Father and with Jesus. Anyone who has questions about the Trinity should consult John's Gospel. Now, it is true there are, for lack of a better term, heretical understandings of the Trinity that often use but distort the teachings of John's Gospel. If we consistently view it from beginning to the end, though, there is an unfolding. It is clear and the mystery is laid bare to us. And that's because Jesus, he has a particular and a peculiar purpose for us as human beings in our life. He has a purpose for us. He wants to save us. He wants to become our salvation. He wants to rescue us from our sins. That's the cross. That's that moment in history. The blood of Jesus paying the price of the debt of sin. The blood of Jesus making clean the unclean. The blood of Jesus touching, saving, and enabling every person to be consecrated as a priest, that is, a communicator with God. The blood of Jesus does all those things for us on the cross. And his death ensures that when we go down, so as he rose from the dead, so we too will rise again from the dead with him. That fundamental act of the cross and the tomb is the cornerstone of our faith. That is the saving act. And John has that in mind from the beginning. He opens the gospel in chapter 1 with Jesus' identity as, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world." That's Jesus' identity. That's who he is. So then I think it is prudent of us to ask a question. The Gospels, all of them, are not primarily Gospels about the deeds of the life of Christ. Even the moment of the crucifixion does not take up that much time. What takes up more time in the Gospels than anything else are the sayings of Jesus, his teachings. And John brings this out especially. Jesus didn't just come to save us, to make us in right relationship with God, to deliver us salvation, but he came to bear witness of the Father to us, to disclose the truth of God to us. Now, this is in all the Gospels. Matthew says, Jesus, in Matthew's Gospel, he says, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things of the kingdom of heaven, from the wise and discerning, but have revealed them to little children. Yes, for such was your gracious will." Jesus, in all the Gospels, very clearly is a witness, but John explicitly brings this out. John the Baptist came to bear witness about Jesus, and Jesus came to bear witness about the Father. Jesus gave his testimony as the Son of God concerning the nature of God, concerning what God wanted, and concerning the timings of God. People always want to speak on behalf of the Father concerning his plans, concerning his heart, concerning his mind. Everybody wants to interpret the Father for us and what God wants for your life. People want that control. But Jesus says, "The Son has set you free." He who the Son sets free is free indeed. Now we may say, we've never been a slave to anyone. But nevertheless, Jesus has come to set us free from control. And the most important way he can do that for us is to reveal to us the truth of the Father, of God's plans for us, to give us a clear picture of what he wants our life to look like. Religious feelings are very powerful feelings. Guilt, is a very powerful motivator. And the Lord doesn't want us to have guilt. He wants us to have freedom. But many Christians live their life as if they are not in freedom, but in bondage. And not on account of their sin, but on account of their faith. Sometimes we even boast, you know, I have to be a Christian because it's just so convincing. I have to follow Jesus because I just must. We don't take joy or delight in the goodness of God or in the glory of His word. We're in bondage, even to freedom. And that's not what the Lord wants for us. And so it's very important to understand the threefold witness of the Father concerning Himself. And that's what we're going to find here. How about we read this passage here? John chapter 5. We can go here. John chapter 5, verses 37. I hope it doesn't bang too much when I'm flipping. John chapter 5, verses 37 to 39. It is a burden on my heart that people feel the joy of the Lord. I don't preach religion. I preach Jesus Christ, the true religion, purity from sin, through forgiveness by the power of the Lamb of God. Jesus, by His might, makes me mighty. And that, my friends, is an easy burden and a light yoke. Jesus is the best news you ever heard. And it's a shame that so often we as believers, we make it bad news. He comes in to bring a burden of holy living. Holy living is not a burden. Let's see this morning Jesus' testimony concerning the will of the Father for our lives. John chapter 5, verses 37 to 39. Let's take a look here. I'm reading again from the English Standard Version. And the Father who sent me has Himself borne witness about me. His voice you have never heard. His form you have never seen. And you do not have His word abiding in you. For you do not believe the one whom He has sent. You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And it is they that bear witness about me. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God for His holy word. How about we pray this morning? Almighty Father, we pray that you would dispense thy Holy Ghost to come upon us, Lord, as we hear from thy word, as we understand the threefold witness of Jesus Christ in these passages concerning yourself. Disclose it to us. Lighten our load. Give us the joy of the Lord, we pray, in Jesus' name. O come, Holy Spirit, abide with us, we pray, through the blood of the Lamb. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so we are talking this morning about the threefold witness of the Father concerning Himself through His Son, Jesus Christ. And there is one that essentially corresponds with each of the three verses I have read. Verse 37 is the holiness of the Father. That's the first thing Jesus reveals for us here. The Father is holy. The second thing Jesus reveals to us about the Father is that the Father has appointed one way. There is one way appointed by the Father for men to know Him, for men to be saved. And the third thing Jesus reveals about the Father is that there is a season of the Father. There is a timing of the Father. And now is the time. Let's do the first thing. The Father has borne witness concerning Jesus Christ. And His form you have not seen at any time. What is the meaning of this? Jesus is explaining to us that if someone tells you they know who God is, if someone tells you they understand who God is, they don't. Man-made religion is very, very powerful. People claim to have revelation. People claim you can understand things through them. The seal of true religion is the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And the revelation of it in its fullness is the cross of Christ. His blood paying the price for our sins. Any religion which does not focus on the glorification of the three-in-one God and of Jesus Christ, that is not the religion from the Father. Now, we may say in our creeds, we may say in our teachings, we may say in our words that we believe in the three-in-one God, that we glorify the three-in-one God, but we need to understand one thing very clearly which Jesus reveals here. It's not that nobody has knowledge of the Father because nobody heard it. It's because the Father cannot be heard, he cannot be seen, he cannot be comprehended by us, period. He is too holy. He's too holy. The Bible tells us that the heavens, even the highest heavens, cannot contain the Father. If that is so, how can the Father really enter and reveal himself fully to us on this earth? How can we afford to see him with our eyes? How can we afford to hear the Holy One of Israel with our words? When Isaiah saw the Lord seated on his throne, he said, "Woe to me! I am an unclean man of unclean lips, and I dwell among an unclean people. I cannot handle the holiness of God. It is too much for me." Even this very idea of his holiness, his scope, God's strength is immeasurable. He's stronger than everything in the world. He's bigger than everything in the world. He's better than everything in the world. There is nothing that compares to him. He is the holy God. He's the amazing God. There's none like him. And so I think, you know, when we think of coming to church to worship the holy God, just taking an example, man-made religion says, I go to church because it's the right thing. Man-made religion says, we worship God because that's what we're supposed to do. Man-made religion says the evidence of God is overwhelming. God-made religion says, I go because Jesus said, I go. I go because Jesus told me to go. I go because Jesus is in my heart and I delight to do the will of God. I go because I love to go. I go because I want to be about my Father's business. I go because the Holy God is the Holy God, and he is so, so amazing. That's what Jesus reveals when he says God is holy beyond compare. If God is holy beyond compare, how can you do anything on behalf of him? How can you do anything for him? How can you know what he thinks or what he wants? You can't make a decision. All we can do is follow Jesus. This is the second one. They tie very close together. Jesus is the one way of the Father. Jesus says to the Pharisees, to the people there who are listening to him, I guess it's not explicitly necessarily only the Pharisees or anything like that, that you do not have his word abiding in you because you do not believe the one he has sent. We need to accept the one the Father has sent. People want authority. People want control. People want domination over other people. And so we try to mediate on behalf of God to people, on behalf of what is right to people. You look to the experts. The experts will tell us what to do in whatever situation. We just elevate them to a high place. The experts will tell us what's in the Bible. Everybody, a human being out there, someone will tell us what's in the Bible. But if you tell someone, Jesus spoke to my heart, Jesus saved my soul, I love Jesus, if you make it about Jesus, it's different. It's got a different quality. We don't go to church because of the pastor. We go to the church because of Jesus. There's only one way to the Holy God. And Jesus, as he's going about, he delights to do the will of the Father. He always does the will of the Father. If Jesus is the only way to the Father, Jesus does not in any way ever look sad about his relationship with God. Find me a passage where you can show me that Jesus is not happy being the Son of the Father. He delights to do the will of God. And so this is the way. This is the full way. Jesus in totality. Often we take faith in just the intellectual aspect and we let the heart die. There is the creeds, there's the beliefs, there's the statement of faith. But the true religion is following and being a true follower of Jesus Christ. Don't look to man to interpret Jesus for you. Live Jesus for yourself in your life. There is only one who can reveal God to you. So the only way you can be saved is if Jesus has touched you. In Ephesians 5:14, it says the light of Christ will shine on you. Unless you've had that light of God directly shine on your soul, unless you've had that personal knowledge of Jesus Christ, How can you know God? Don't go through man-made routes to have knowledge of the Holy One. Don't go through man-made teachings. Go through only Jesus Christ. We accept pastors, we accept teachers, we accept, you know, people explaining things to us because they're supposed to align identical with what Jesus says. That way we can verify and discern if what the pastor, if what whoever is teaching us is true. We can find in the Bible and understand for ourselves. We do not accept things on an authority basis because there's only one Holy One. And there's only one who reveals that Holy One, and that is Jesus. So there is only one with authority of your life. And it's not yourself. It's not you. It's Jesus. And Jesus, no matter the cost, even up to his own life, no matter the price of pain, even up to being called Man of Sorrows, no matter what it was, to death, down through the grave itself, to the realm of the dead and up, he followed the Father. No man take my life from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. Jesus struggled, but he always gave it to the Father, fully, completely, happily, and totally. And so when we say that Jesus is the only way to the Father, we mean that Jesus in his life, Jesus in his teachings, all that is revealed here in the scripture, that is the way. It's not just the cross, and I don't mean that to denigrate the cross in any way. It's not just what he's done for you on Calvary. It's the life lived as well through the cross that saves you. Because Jesus lived his life with the cross in mind, but there was a life lived. And so with us, if we have the cross in our heart, if we're washed by the blood, we're going to live with the cross in mind. That's the one way that Jesus talks about. Jesus took on flesh so he could give his life on the cross. A body you have prepared for me. That's the testimony of scripture. And so you and I, there is a body. There is a life. There is something God has prepared for us to live. And we're going to live it out like gospel pages. There's going to be deeds. There's going to be teachings. There's going to be sayings. There's going to be rest. There's going to be work. That's the life. That's the only way for a man to be saved is through a total life meditation on all the life of Christ, leaving not one part out. Jesus is the only way is, I think, the most profound and misunderstood biblical statement. It's not just that Jesus is the only gate, the only entry point. He's the only revelation. No one can theorize or speculate about the Holy One. He's too high. He's too above. He's too far beyond us. The only one who can connect us is one who is God himself. You see that? Jesus has to be God as the Father is God. Otherwise, how can he see the Father to reveal the Father to us? Only Jesus can do that for us. And now I want to move to that next verse. You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have life. That's verse 39. But it is these that testify about me. It is these that testify about me. You know, we talk a lot about the Bible. And I was talking a lot at the beginning and throughout about man-made religion. Man-made religion appears holy. And it can lead people to be good people. I don't think the Pharisees, when we read about them, are necessarily bad people. They have their sins, but I mean, who doesn't have their sins? Jesus' primary problem with them is that they do not accept his testimony about himself. He has qualms about their morality as well. We find this in Matthew 23, especially. Jesus has things to say about the sins of the Pharisees. But generally, the main thing Jesus wants to get on about is the testimony concerning himself. His identity is the centrality of the Gospels, the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. That's verse 1 of the beginning of the Gospels, Matthew 1. It's all about him. And unless our life is all about Jesus, then we can't make it. I want to say there's a season of the Father. And I picked this season because I want us to think of like baseball season. I don't know if you have a sports fan in your family. I'm actually not really one. I'm I guess, you know, I don't do a whole lot. I have to confess, I just spat over there. And, you know, I don't do a whole lot of these sports things or anything like that. But I've known people, when it's baseball season, the hat's out, the shirt's out. It's the season of baseball. It's baseball season. They know the scores. You can catch them on Tuesday. What's the game this week? You know, I don't follow sports. So when you have someone who follows them, I like to ask just to know who's winning. How's the season doing? If it's the season, someone who's in the season can give you all the answers for any of your sports questions. You can think of that for anything. At Shiloh, it's shoebox season. It's Christmas shoebox season all the time. You want to know about shoebox season? Ask someone. They're going to tell you what's the stats, what's the items, what's needed. There's a season. And the Father has appointed a season for all men. Jesus. You see, you can't just memorize the Bible. You can't just know it. You've got to be in the Bible season. And the Bible season is all about the triune God. It's all about the cross. It's all about the glorification of Jesus Christ. It's about the blood. It's about the Holy Spirit touching us. It's about all these things. These are throughout all of Scripture. That relationship with God. If you are in the Bible season, you can't just search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have life, but it is these that testify about me. Jesus himself is the life of men. Jesus himself is the light of men. By Jesus himself, I see. Jesus is the season for your life. Jesus is that season. Whether spring, summer, fall, or winter, the season of your life, it better be Jesus Christ o'clock every second of the day. That's the only way. It's not just reading the Bible. It's not just having devotion time. It's not just Bible study, getting Bible studies or theological knowledge. You have to be in the Jesus season. There is no greater contradiction to me. And I actually don't have anyone in particular in mind. I think of myself, actually, how, you know, I used to live too. There's no greater contradiction to me than to pick up the Word of God, read it, meditate on it, memorize it, then go and waste our time with frivolities, whether it's watching obscene R-rated movies or something like that, or doing something like that, or entertaining ourselves. So often we have Bible time, and then the Bible season ends, and the season for the other things in our life begins. And nothing could be more wrong than that. That's man-made religion, though. And that's the religion that people find burdensome. That's the hard religion to live out and to follow. Because then church time interrupts all the other time. Then Bible time interrupts the other time. Pray time interrupts the other important things. And those things, the Jesus things, they fall to the bottom of the list. And we got to bring them back up on the priority list. Sometimes we feel guilty. So we elevate them to high list. We make them the most time. Sometimes we talk about that, right? We're going to give more time to Jesus than ever before. That not so. There's only one season for the believer. Whether in season or out of season, we are the Lord's. Whether living or dead, we are the Lord's. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. Every day, every second, you have been bought by Jesus Christ, for he whom the Son sets free is free indeed. There is no other authority in your life. Only in Christ is freedom found and the joy of true religion. Only if we give Jesus our whole life, all of it, and I really do mean all of it, but we truly experience that unmitigated joy. There's nothing like a surrendered life. But in another sense, sometimes it's the most challenging thing because we're not fully surrendered. Don't we all know something about not being fully surrendered to God? But we do it to our own hurt. We do it to our own harm. We don't do it to our benefit. Jesus came that we may have life and have it abundantly. But because our deeds are evil, we love the darkness rather than light. And there's nothing sadder than that. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. And I think that's true of the church today. Jesus has come, and we did not receive him. Like the Pharisees, we give Jesus his time. We'll let Jesus teach here, let Jesus teach there, let Jesus do that. But when Jesus says, no, no, it's all about me. It's all about me. The Father has testified in his holiness and in his exclusive witness that Jesus Christ alone, it's all about me. All history, all humankind, all life, it's about the Son of Man, Son of God. It's all about me. We do not receive that testimony. Would you pray with me this morning? If you have not believed in Jesus Christ, if you would like to accept Jesus as the full Lord of your life, and I mean, you know, whether we're a believer or not, fully surrendering a life to Jesus can be very challenging. But that's the way to the Holy God. And there's no other way. And when we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. Would you pray with me this morning, accept Jesus into your heart and give total surrender to Jesus if that's not something you're striving for every day? How about we try that this morning? Let's pray. Almighty and Holy Father, we praise thee and we thank thee for what thou hast done through the cross and thy Son Jesus. May we walk with thee. When you say follow, may we hear our names, and may in our feet and our ankles be given strength sufficient to stand, to leap for joy, walking and leaping and praising God. Thank you, Jesus, so much for the cross, for giving us this chance, for coming as a witness, as a revelation. Lord, I thank thee that the time has come for all who hear the preaching of the gospel to have a fully surrendered life to Jesus Christ, the only way. We praise thee and we thank thee, O Lord, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Would you receive the benediction? Be blessed this morning, my friends. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And you blessed of the Lord, be blessed in your going out, be blessed in your coming in, from now till forevermore, world without end. Amen. Amen. I feel like I missed some Beatitudes. It felt really short. I must have missed some. I'm sorry if I missed any. My friends, this morning, the threefold witness of Jesus Christ concerning the Father is that the Father bears witness that Jesus alone knows the holiness of God. That's the first testimony of the Father concerning himself. He's holy. He sent Jesus to tell us, ain't nobody know me. Only Jesus knows me. Don't listen to anybody else. Don't follow any other teacher. Don't follow any other guru. Because I have made Jesus not only the revealer of my holiness, but also the only way to have fellowship and communion with me. And that Trinity, that three-in-one God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah in the 63rd chapter, I alone have trodden the winepress. Jesus alone. He looked and he found none to help. He alone, God alone, brought us salvation. We accept no co-redemptrix, whether it is Mary or anyone else, into the saving work of God. For no one can claim to work on behalf of God except for God. Only he can work that great salvation, that rescue, and that deliverance. Only God alone saved us. He alone and no other is our salvation. Even when the pastor preaches a sermon, it's just a vessel through which you come to know God. If there is truth in the minister, it's not of himself. This is because he has the living word abiding in him. If you meet a man of God, they're just that, a man from God. Someone who has been with God through Jesus and can speak the words of Jesus, all of which is confirmed here in the scripture. Because as Jesus says, not only is God the Father holy, not only is Jesus the only way, but this testifies concerning him. In a gospel life, from birth to death is the only life worth living. And that's why, my friends, Christianity, being a Christian, following Jesus, is always in season. Who's your favorite player? Doesn't matter, Jesus. Jesus. What's your favorite book? Doesn't matter, the Bible. Not because I have to, but because I want to. That's true religion of the heart, because Jesus willingly gave his life. Jesus willingly laid down his will, not my will, but your will be done. Jesus willingly was constantly in agreement with the Father, because God is love. And so we too, we can brook no contradiction. We can allow nothing to creep in and to upset our communion, our fellowship, our relationship with our Almighty and our Holy God. I hope you found this message encouraging, my friends, and I hope you have a fantastic week. Take care, and God bless.